So I've always been very fascinated with this whole idea of how things are going to change in the future. And I've always enjoyed thinking about the future, not just in terms of new business models, but even in terms of just the way kids think about the future, in terms of the Isaac Asimov, the science fiction way of thinking about the future. And back when I was a kid in the 80s, growing up, one of my favorite movies used to be this movie called Back to the Future. How many of you here have seen this movie?
Yeah.
Good. So that's great. So you'll understand the analogy that I'm going to bring in over here. Back to the Future, in the movie, the characters take a car and they fly off into the future. And interestingly, the future that they fly off into, according to the dashboard that they have on the car, is going to happen exactly 6 months from now. It's October 2015. So if we were to believe in that movie, we're already in the future. The problem, though, is that we don't have cars that fly yet. We're talking about driverless cars, but we don't have flying cars yet. So clearly, the way the movie thought of the future didn't really work out. In fact, my disappointment was shared by Peter Thiel when he said, we wanted flying cars, but instead you gave us 140 characters. And that's the future that we live in, unfortunately, quote unquote, today, where we don't have flying cars, but we have 140 characters. So clearly, the way we thought about the future, the things that used to get us excited, didn't really turn out that way. The future sort of pulled the carpet from under our feet. We wanted flying cars, and instead we got something else. Well, what I want to do today is talk about a future that is a lot brighter than what we ever thought, because we didn't get flying cars and because we got 140 characters. What I want to weave over the next few minutes is a narrative that shows a different version of the future. And I want to start by throwing a few different pictures that show the kind of future that we are moving towards. And if you look at some of these things that I'm going to talk about, you'll realize that the shift that is happening is way bigger than software eating the world. It's way bigger than social media, sharing economy, 3D printing. It's way bigger than all of this. All of these are merely manifestations of a much larger shift that are happening today. And all of this will actually be substituted with even more kinds of manifestations in the future of the same shift that's happening right now. So to start this discussion, I want to borrow a quote that I read in TechCrunch last month, and it says that in 2015, the world's largest taxi company does not own the taxis, the world's largest media company does not create the media that it monetizes, the world's largest retailer does not own the inventory, and the world's largest accommodation provider does not own any rooms. And that's the future we live in. So clearly, it's a future where nobody owns anything, and still they seem to make a lot of money. In fact, all of them go to billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar valuations in a few years. But that's a very accurate picture of the future that we live in today. There's a specific reason this thing is happening today and did not happen 5 years back. The internet happened way back in the 90s, or rather, the internet was there for the last 60 years, but the internet became democratized and became something that users could use back in the 90s. But this shift took a whole 20 to 25 years to take place. And there's a reason for that, because the internet, the way it happened for the first 15 years, was very different from the internet that has happened to us over the last 7 to 8 years, and that's what I want to talk about. Let's talk about what's happening today. The first shift that I want to talk about is this. We talked about the Pope visiting the Philippines. Let's talk about people visiting the Pope in the Vatican. This is a picture that you've probably seen before. It's a picture of the papal ceremony at the Vatican in two different years, 2005 and 2013. Interestingly, 2005 was when Nokia and BlackBerry were market leader, then 2013 was when they were almost bankrupt and sold for pittance. And the key shift that we see between these 2 years, 2005 and 2013, is that in 2005, the internet was something we used to sit at a desk and access. And in 2013, the internet was something we didn't access anymore. We were always on the internet. So there is no digital, there is no physical, there is no offline, there is no online. Do you believe you're offline or online right now? You're always online. In fact, as we move from mobile to wearables, we'll be online even when we sleep, because we'll be monitoring our sleep, and that data will constantly be streamed. So there is no offline and online distinction anymore. There's no physical digital distinction anymore, to be really precise. What's important is, are you connected or are you not connected? That's the only distinction that remains. And the reason that's important is because in today's world, A truck that is connected to the internet is a lot more digital and a lot more online than a computer that is not. So it's not a question of whether it's a truck or a computer, whether it's physical or digital, it's a question of are you connected or not. So the first big shift that has happened in the last 5 to 8 years, which is pretty much what this picture also shows, has been the democratization of access. All of us have access to a global market at any point in time. Right now, you're tweeting about this. You're taking a picture and hashtagging it and sending it outside, and that's because you have access. Sometime back, 10 years back for that matter, you would not be doing that because you did not have access. Nobody would be out there waiting to hear from you. But today, you have access. Now, that's the first picture I wanted to show you. The second picture is a bit more complex. It's a lot more technical, but it shows the second big shift that's happening in the world today. The first big shift is the democratization of access. The second big shift is what I want to show through this picture. You've probably seen this before. What's important, what we're trying to show over here, is that the world has fundamentally changed from a world where we were all consumers to a world where we are all producers. I can see people taking pictures right now. You are in the act of producing. 10 to 12 years back, you would not be doing this. Instead, you would be sitting and listening to this, and there would be no production of value from your side. It would just be production of value from one side. And what's happening today is all of us are producing all the time. And it's not just about people taking selfies with cameras. If you think of what 3D printers will do, it will make each of us a potential manufacturing plant. There are many different ways in which all of us are moving towards production in today's world, and this is a really important shift because traditionally we've been called couch potatoes because that's what we were. We were consumers only. So the big shift that's happening is the democratization of production. The third big shift that's happening right now is one in which we do not have flying cars, but one in which the world is already giving us thinking thermostats. You probably do not know how Nest works because Nest is not really popular out here. But what Nest does is Nest is a thermostat that constantly captures data about its environment to become even more intelligent. So it's a thinking thermostat. It learns about your behavior and it changes itself accordingly. But more importantly, it learns from every other thermostat in the neighborhood and it changes based on that because then it can change based on how the climate is changing around it. It learns from other people like you. If you're the bachelor using Nest, it learns from other Nest thermostats in your city which are being used by bachelors. And it accordingly changes its own behavior based on that. And so we have a thermostat that's learning from a whole community of thermostats. It's something that's not been possible in the past. And this is the third shift, which I think of as the democratization of intelligence. We call it the Internet of Things. It's not, the sensor part of the Internet of Things is not important. That's the most ridiculous part of it. It's the most basic part of it. What's important is what happens after the sensor. Today, everything, the table that you have over here, the floor that you're standing on, or the seat that you're sitting on, all of these things can be computers because intelligence is getting democratized. It's no longer restricted to just computers or to mobile phones. Everything can be a computer in the world tomorrow. And this is incredibly important, and it's happening because of something that we call the cloud. We often think of all of these as technology, but the cloud is very simple. The cloud is just a brain that has been detached from its body. A computer is a brain and a body in the same being, whereas the cloud is a central brain that a lot of different bodies can connect to. It's as simple as that. There's nothing more complex, more complicated than that when you think about the cloud. So it's these three big shifts that are happening right now, which are changing the way the world works. And with these three pictures, I want to talk about the real large shift in economy that's happening right now that got me so excited that I wanted to dedicate my life towards understanding this better and helping companies across industries, helping future governments and cities think about how they need to move along this shift to actually perform much better in the world that's coming in front of us. So to talk about this shift, I want to talk about what the world used to look like and what a lot of the world still looks like. Traditionally, we've used this word a lot, and I want to use it in a very specific way. Traditionally, the world has moved in a straight line. It's not just grown in a straight line, it's moved in a straight line. And that's what I think of as pipes. Our businesses have traditionally worked like pipes. Television works like a pipe. Somebody creates something, pushes it down the pipe, and there's a whole group of people sitting at the other end watching it. Toyota works like a pipe. Manufacturing works like a pipe. And it's a straight line. That's why it's called a supply chain. It works, moves in a straight line. And the reason we have these pipes is very simple. Because if you want to create anything in this world, if you want to create any form of value in this world, you need to ensure that resources and people, labor, are aligned in a manner that they work together to create value. And in the past, the only way you could align resources and people together was by putting them inside an office, putting them inside a factory, and organizing them in the straight line. This is the real power of the internet. The internet no longer needs us to sit in one place and coordinate all of our actions physically and aggregate things in a straight line to create value. Because of the internet, new forms of value creation can be created where people are, or things or anything is absolutely dispersed, but they're working together because the central network and the central brain coordinates all of their activities. And this is the big shift I want to talk about. We're moving from a world where things used to work like pipes to a world where things are working like platforms. And when I use the word platform, the first thing that often comes to mind, since we use this term very often in technology, but again, I want to say this clearly, that this is not about technology, it's about how the world works. It just so happens that technology is changing how the world works. When we think of platforms, the first thing we think of is the Android or the Apple platform. Now, I want you to notice this very carefully. The shape of the business has fundamentally changed. It's no longer the straight line business. In this model, what happens is the business acts as an infrastructure on which external parties create value and external parties consume value, and then the business manages the interactions between these two sides. And in the process, it owns nothing. And that's what happens on the Apple or Android platform. External developers come in and create apps, and consumers come in and consume those apps. And a whole market of these apps is created on top of the platform. But this is not something that's happening only with Apple or an Android or the smartphone. The smartphone is not disruptive. What is disruptive is this change in business, because this change in business design is happening across the industry. If you think of what is happening with Airbnb, it's the same business design. Hosts come and create their room availability on top of Airbnb's platform. And Airbnb manages this market and allows them to interact with each other. YouTube works in the same manner. The only difference is that we are both producers and consumers on YouTube. But at a specific point in time, we are performing one of these two roles. It's still working in the same platform model. And finally, if you think of Twitter, Twitter again works in the same model. There are people who create tweets, people who consume tweets. The same person may be doing both and may keep shifting between the roles every few minutes. But the value is created because of these two sides interacting with each other. So what we see today is that the design of business is changing. This is the real impact of technology. If you had to explain to someone why is technology changing the world, why is software eating the world, in one line, it's just this, that because of technology, you can now connect external ecosystems of producers and consumers and allow them to interact with each other. Whereas before the internet, you had to accumulate people inside a company and create all of that value. So fundamentally, the way businesses work have completely changed because of this shift towards platforms. Now clearly, this is something that we're seeing happening across industries. If you are on the other side, if you are a pipe, you are seeing this shift happening to you. So let's look at how this is happening across industries. TV channels worked in straight lines. I'm sorry, David, I keep getting back to TV channels all the time. Work in straight lines. YouTube doesn't own the inventory, works in a platform model, has much more choice, and has much more total viewing time than all the TV channels combined. Encyclopedia Britannica was created using a traditional pipe model. Somebody decided what content should go in, somebody created the content, somebody else edited the content, and then you distributed it through a certain mechanism. And Wikipedia is a constant living organism that is a constantly evolving encyclopedia. In fact, the moment something happens, you see the Wikipedia page corresponding to that, edited and updated, which is never possible with a traditional encyclopedia. So we're seeing a whole supply chain being restructured into a platform. This is probably the biggest example of platforms completely disrupting an industry. Nokia and BlackBerry lost more than 95% of their market share in a matter of 8 years, because they used to work like pipes. They would preload the applications onto the handset. But Apple, because it made a platform, it made your handset extendable into any phone in the world, into any possible machine in the world. In the past, you would just carry a phone and maybe a camera phone. But today, you carry something in your pocket which can do a host of different things, of which making calls is just one very small thing. And finally, hotels traditionally have worked in a very pipe model. If a hotel wants to expand, it has to set up more rooms. It has to create more staff to manage those rooms. But if Airbnb wants to expand, all it needs to do is sign up more hosts and ensure that it sends the right travelers to them. So we're seeing this shift happening repeatedly. It's not something happening in one corner. So if you believe that your industry works by the rules of the world, it's a matter of time before this shift happens to your industry as well. There are four specific ways in which this shift happens, and this may help you understand even better whether your industry is about to be threatened by this. The first and most important reason this shift happens, and that's beyond these four things, but the single most important reason this shift happens is because most industries work on information, and the internet is information technology democratized. Media is an industry which works on information. And the internet changes that, because the internet changes anything that works on information. Banking works on information. Banking is not about moving money from one place to the other. It's merely about moving information about money from one place to the other. The only difference is that banking is more regulated than the internet than media today, and that's why it's holding off. But even that is getting disrupted right now. Telecom is an information-based industry that got disrupted. Healthcare is an information industry. Healthcare is really just about patient data and taking decisions on the basis of that data. And that data has to be moved around between radiologists, between different kinds of people in the healthcare system, all of which can be reconfigured because of platforms. And it's already starting to happen. Education is an information-based industry that is waiting to be disrupted. And even if you think of traditional industries like mining and oil and gas, I've helped even these companies move to platforms, because oil and gas, the single most important competitive advantage is finding new sources of oil, which is an information problem. And that again can be solved much more efficiently using platforms. So it's not a question of what's online, what's offline, what's digital and what is not. Every industry in the world that has an information component has the potential to be disrupted by platforms. And to date, I've worked across industries. I've never come across one industry that does not have an information component. So let me talk about four things that happen repeatedly when different industries get transformed. And if you see any of these four things in your industry, I'd say the alarm bells are ringing. There's probably some reason it hasn't happened already. But if you're in that industry, I would go out and try to figure out something to fix this. So the first thing that happens is that platforms remove gatekeepers. Some of the industries that have been traditionally plagued by gatekeepers are publishing industries. I'm writing a book right now for which I've signed a big deal with Norton in the US. It's a very traditional publishing model, and it works really slow. And what Amazon does is it changes the whole thing. It becomes a much more scalable gatekeeper than some guy sitting in the middle who decides what the market wants. Instead, Amazon lets the market decide what the market wants. So platforms remove inefficient gatekeepers. A lot of industries have gatekeepers today. Venture capital has gatekeepers, and that's why crowdfunding is becoming so popular. Media, all forms of media has had gatekeepers. The music industry has had gatekeepers, and that's why Justin Bieber had to be found on the internet, whereas the Beatles had to go and audition club by club. The second thing that platforms do is they unlock new sources of value, and this is extremely important, because whenever I talk about this, there's somebody in the audience who says, but you're just taking things away from the old guard and bringing it to the new guard, and that's not true. Is there anyone over here running a home on Airbnb, a B&B on Airbnb, a host? Yeah, great. Did you run a hotel before this? Did you run a hotel before this? No, you did not, right? So Airbnb is not simply taking value from somewhere and moving it somewhere else. It's creating entirely new value. And this is what platforms do. Because they provide you market access, they end up creating entirely new value. And so you end up seeing competition from people who are not your competitors, because they are in the business of creating entirely new value. The third thing that platforms do is they aggregate highly fragmented and inefficient markets. Think of what TripAdvisor did to the travel industry. Before TripAdvisor, when you would travel somewhere, you would ask your friends and family where to stay, what to do. But now you just go on to TripAdvisor and decide where you want to stay based on the reviews over there. And that's because that created a platform for users to contribute reviews back about a hotel and for hotels to interact with those users, and in the process created a rating system that is no longer just a digital commodity. It's something that has huge real value in the real world. People put certificates from TripAdvisor in their hotels because a value that they gained online has tremendous value offline. And the final thing that platforms do when they change industry is they enable new production paradigms, and that's what Wikipedia did in the example that I gave. It took a traditional supply chain and moved it onto a platform model. So let's talk about how do you go about building these platforms. Clearly, this is not something that I can cover in 20 minutes over here, but I want to lay a few, just leave out a few thoughts that you can go back with and think about how it applies to you in the companies that you're working in. The first thing about building a platform is do not start with the technology, because this is the easiest way to fail with a platform. The only company that I know of that succeeded by starting with technology is Twitter. It created a platform and it did not know itself what it was going to be used for. In fact, a lot of people still don't know what Twitter is used for. But Twitter was this platform that was created which was about writing 140 characters, and nobody knew what to do with it, and suddenly there were so many different use cases, but that does not happen all the time. Instead, what's important is to focus on the interaction that you are going to enable between people. Don't focus on the 140 characters, focus on the interaction. And the way to do that is start with the core unit of value that you want to be exchanged. Because everything in the world is about exchanging value between two sides, producers and consumers. Start with that core unit of value. In YouTube, it's a video. On Kickstarter, it's a project. On Airbnb, it's a listing. Without this core unit of value, the platform has no value at all. So figure out, think of what that core unit of value is, and then you'll be able to think of how you create the platform that enables that exchange. So figure out that core unit of value, use that to design the interaction. Who is creating that value? Who is consuming that value? And finally, once you've laid all of that out, only then go to a point where you think about technology. The only role technology plays is it scales this interaction at a global level. Things that you are tweeting right now, in the past you would have discussed with people across the table. The only thing that technology does is it enables that same interaction at scale. So if you want to build a platform, you have to start with the interaction, because the interaction has always been there. The platform is just making it more scalable and efficient. The way the platform does it is threefold. And if you're running a company and you want to apply platform thinking, you need to think of how you're doing these three things in particular. The three things all go back to one central goal, and the goal is that the goal of a platform is to enable interactions between producers and consumers. If you had to take just one thing out of here, just take this. Whether technology plays a role in that or not is secondary. If technology does, as it most often does, that's great. But the key role is not to build great technology and not to create beautiful apps, but to enable interactions between producers and consumers. So let's talk about platform design and the three roles I was talking about. The first thing platforms need to do is they need to pull the two sides together. So if Twitter does not have people creating tweets and people reading tweets, or if Uber does not have drivers and passengers, it's absolutely useless, right? So the first thing that the platform needs to do is it needs to pull the two sides in. And this is often much more complex than it appears, because there's a chicken and egg problem over here. Without producers, there are no consumers, and without consumers, there are no producers. There are many ways to solve that problem. We don't have time to get into that right now, but that's one of the key things that you need to solve when you're building a platform. The second thing is that you need to build not just the technology, but also the rules of governance. What kinds of interactions are allowed? What kinds of people are not allowed on the platform? How do we decide whether somebody is allowed or not allowed? For example, if a driver on Uber gets less than a 4.5 star rating, he kind of gets kicked out. And that's a way of deciding which kinds of people should be or should not be allowed on the platform. So there should be rules that decide how you want to facilitate these interactions. And finally, there's a lot of talk about big data that I see, but a lot of those discussions still talk about analytics, which is, we have all of this data, how can we get more intelligence out of it? But I think that's missing the point, because we are in a world where we have the opportunity to collect data that we could not collect in the past. Because of the way people are using technology, there's an opportunity to collect new kinds of data. If you think of what happened to Monster.com, Monster.com was this job search portal. It was a platform because it connected job seekers with people who wanted to offer jobs. But it got disrupted by LinkedIn because LinkedIn captured way more data than Monster ever could about the people who were looking for jobs. And in the process, Monster would cater only to people who were actively looking for jobs. LinkedIn would tell you that you needed a job before you yourself knew about it. And that was possible because LinkedIn focused on figuring out how to capture more and more data. So the third thing that platforms need to do is keep on capturing data so that you can match the producers and consumers and the value and consumers to each other on a consistent basis. So the three things platforms need to do is they need to pull, facilitate, and match. An easy way of remembering this is that all of this lines up very nicely with the word platform. You need to pull, facilitate, and match. Those are the three key things you need to do when you're running a platform. Now, this is interesting because this begs the question, what is and isn't a platform? How many things out there are platforms? Let's look at that stack, the network, the tools and rules, and the data that we just laid out over here, and try to think of a few different things. Social networks are platforms where the network layer is really, really thick, right? All kinds of whatever you think of as social media, it works on the platform model. Whatever you think of as the sharing economy of people sharing things with other people works on the platform model because there's a network that is being enabled by a central tool, the layer of tools and rules, and data is being used to determine who should be matched to whom. Uber uses data to decide which driver should be matched to which traveler. The second model of platforms are ones which have really thick tools and rules. So think of developer platforms like Android. The technology is really thick. The network is relatively thin. But it still works on the same set of principles. Think of content platforms like Medium, the blogging platform. That, again, is a case where tools and rules are thick. The others are relatively thin. The idea is not to say that some things are social networks and some things are content platforms. The whole boundaries between different kinds of platforms is blurring, and that's the reason I lay out these three layers so that your own platform could have its own combination of these layers. Finally, data platforms. Nest is a data platform. You would never think of Nest as a social network because it's just a thermostat. That's what you see. But the way Nest works is the way Wikipedia works. It's the way Waze works, and it's the way, in a way, Facebook works. If you think of how Facebook works, it takes all of the updates from all of your friends and then filters out what is most relevant to you and serves that to you in your newsfeed. What Nest does is it takes data from all the thermostats in the city, filters out the data that is most relevant to a particular thermostat, and serves it that data. The model of working is exactly the same. We don't see it because we are just too caught up in what we see in the manifestation that we see in front of us. And that's why Nest is something with a very thin layer of network and a very thick layer of data. It still works on the platform model. And this is the reason almost everything today has the potential to move to a platform model. We may not see it today. We may think of it as physical versus digital, but a lot of those things that we don't traditionally think of digital can also be moved towards a platform model. You don't have to be on the internet per se. Then Nest isn't a website. It isn't something on the internet. It's just a thermostat. But it still works just like Facebook, as I mentioned just now. Craigslist and Airbnb, think of how two different platforms competed. Craigslist had a really thick network layer, really poor on data. And Airbnb did a much better job on the data and the tools and rules layer. It allowed the transaction to happen through the platform itself. And it created more and more kinds of insurance. MySpace and Facebook. MySpace had a very thick network layer, but almost no data. Facebook has a very thick network layer now, but the real reason you use Facebook, and you did not use MySpace so often, or Friendster in the Philippines back then, is because of the newsfeed. The reason you used to go to Friendster was when you actually wanted to talk to someone. Whereas you go to Facebook even when you don't want to talk to someone because of the newsfeed, because it creates a need in you that is so passive that you can keep coming back to it even when you don't have an active need to express yourself. YouTube and Vimeo, again, two examples of very similar products, very similar websites, but totally different platforms, and that's why they exist, because Vimeo focuses on the technology part of it, YouTube focuses on the network and data side of it. So I want to run through the rest of it a bit fast because we're running low on time, but let's talk about what platform thinking specifically means. There are a few different things that you need to think of. The first thing is that the ecosystem is the new warehouse. Think of Amazon the ecosystem of merchants around the US, all of them serve as the central, as the warehouse for things that are sold on the Amazon website. So you don't need to own everything, you need to have everything in your ecosystem. That's the only thing that you need. Liquidity is the new inventory. Airbnb does not succeed just by signing a lot of hosts. It succeeds by ensuring that every host gets matched to the right traveler, and that's liquidity. A market where everybody does not see activity is not a liquid market, and that's a case of platform failure. Whereas what's important is not just to focus on inventory, but to focus on liquidity when you're running a platform. Community management, we often think of it as something which is an extension of marketing, but it's actually the new human resources. Because if you think that value is being created not by internal employees, but by external producers, then the way you manage your internal employees, you need to manage your external producers as well. And that's why community management is the new human resources. Curation and reputation is the new quality control. Platforms do not go through a lot of rigorous background checks. They usually rely on curation and reputation. All platforms take a combination of centralized checks and curation and reputation that is provided by social feedback in terms of voting, in terms of rating. So the way you think of quality fundamentally changes. Customer journeys are the new sales funnels. In the past, you would take people through a sales funnel till you sold something to them. But today, you need to follow that person across all the various touch points that he has with the business. And that's why data becomes important, because at every touch point, you need to extract data from them and use that to serve them even better at a different touch point. And finally, data is the new dollar. Just like you in your businesses incentivize people, salespeople, for the amount of dollars they brought in, you need to start incentivizing people for the amount of data they capture for your business. That's what LinkedIn does internally, and that's why it has such really good data. And that's what all businesses will need to do in the future, incentivize data capture. Let's talk very quickly about platform scale. Maria had briefly alluded to this, so I want to be very quick with this. We see something very common happening across platforms when they scale. And that's the point at which they move from linear to polynomial, or in some cases, exponential scale. I'm just being mathematically correct. Not all platforms scale exponentially, but all of them scale non-linearly, or polynomially, if you will. So there's an inflection point at which things start becoming really fast. There's one for Airbnb over here. There's one for Postmates that happened recently. WhatsApp had an inflection point. LinkedIn had its inflection point at some point, not just in terms of users, but also in terms of revenues. And 3D printing had an inflection point over here. This is the growth of 3D printing designs on a platform called Thingiverse. And it shows that at some point, the adoption of 3D printing went into exponential trajectory. So I want to explain why things move from this linear to exponential model over the last 5 to 7 minutes that we have right now. There are specific reasons why platforms scale exponentially and not linearly. The first reason is that you have zero marginal cost of expansion. If Marriott has to expand, it has to spend a lot of money building new hotels. Airbnb does not put in that kind of money. Look at the tweet that Brian Chesky cheekily mentions over here. In 2 weeks, Airbnb puts up all the rooms that Marriott needs a whole year to put up. But the real reason for non-linear huge scale is something called network effects. The way network effects work is, if you own something, if you own a telephone, if you're the only person owning the telephone, it's not useful. But if everybody else owns the telephone, it becomes very useful. The more the number of people owning the telephone, the more useful it gets. Now, in case of platforms, it's even more interesting. The more the number of people producing on the platform, the more useful it gets for consumers. And the more the number of people consuming on the platform, the more useful it gets for producers. So both sides sort of feed in each other. And so a platform, once it crosses this inflection point, doesn't need to invest in marketing dollars anymore in the way a traditional business does, because each side keeps pulling the other side to the platform. The third reason that scale happens so fast is behavior design. Think of it. You download approximately 30 to 40 apps on your phone, maybe 100, but you use only 3 to 5 of them on a daily basis. And these are apps that have figured out how to create a new behavior for you. In the past, 15 years back, you did not look for a way to communicate with people in the US or somewhere else. But today, you go to Twitter and you do it because it's a new behavior that you have. In the past, if you saw something beautiful, you would just capture it. But today, you capture it and you think of the kind of tagline you'll fix with it. And these are all new behaviors. So platforms create new behaviors. This does not just happen. There are very specific ways. There are very specific, I'd call them user manipulation techniques that platforms use to create new behaviors. The fourth thing that creates such exponential scale is learning filters. The reason MySpace did not engage users in an exponential fashion was because you had to go to MySpace only when you wanted to communicate with somebody. But Facebook has exponentially high usage because you go there just when you want to browse through your feed, and in the process of browsing through your feed, you end up communicating. So what the newsfeed does is it learns more about you, and it changes how the platform creates value for you. So essentially, Facebook is a product that is unique for every single person because of learning filters, because these filters learn what you want, and based on that, they change themselves. And the fifth and final reason the scale is so high is because of something called virality. And I want to quickly talk about this, because very often, this is confused with something called word of mouth. Virality and going viral is not the same as word of mouth. Word of mouth is what happens when somebody likes what you do so much that they tell other people about it. If I use Instagram, I don't go around telling people about Instagram, and yet it spread virally. Because virality is something where you allow the user to create something on your business and then spread it externally on another network. That's what Instagram did. It allowed people to create pictures on Instagram and then spread that picture on Facebook. So nobody went around telling people, hey, why don't you download Instagram? It's so good. I really love it. They just shared their pictures, and that's how Instagram became popular, which is completely different from word of mouth. Word of mouth is something that can happen both online and both on network and off network. Virality is something that needs a network. And today, a lot of companies say they're going viral. They're going to go viral. All they mean very often is that they're going to rely on something called word of mouth. You cannot control word of mouth, but you can potentially manipulate or encourage users towards taking your business viral. And that's where there are these five different things that lead to this kind of scale. Very often, we just say it's the internet, or it's just digital. But these are the five specific reasons this kind of exponential, non-linear scale happens. So you need to figure how you need to think about whether you're using these five different things in your business today. I want to just skip this part and get to one last bit. I want to talk about how feedback loops propel platform businesses. And I'll take the example of Uber over here, which is one of my favorite examples in terms of feedback loops. What happens on all platforms is both sides attract each other. That's what I just mentioned some time back. Network effects happen. So if you think of Uber, the more the number of cab requests that are happening on the platform, more drivers will come on board. And as more drivers come on board, more cab requests keep happening. So you'd have, beyond a point in a particular city, you don't need to invest in marketing the way you would invest when you were starting off. Whereas in a pipe business, you always have to keep investing in the same way in marketing. So let's see how this works exactly. And I'm borrowing some parts of it from a very popular tweet that David Sachs tweeted out some time back. And I'm going to extend it to show a few more mechanics over here. What happens is when more drivers come on the road, it leads to greater coverage in the city. And when there's greater coverage in the city, it leads to faster pickup times. Because the one reason, the one single reason that Uber could fail is if a consumer opens his app and sees no taxi available. If I was running a company like Uber, I would look at all of those situations where that is happening and try to minimize those number of situations. It's as simple as that. Because that is a case of, we are a platform, but we cannot enable your interaction. What happens as more and more taxi drivers come on board is that its ability to provide the right taxi to the right passenger increases over time. And as a result of that, as every driver gets more and more business, Uber has the potential to lower prices over time. But what this also leads to is, as each and every individual driver sees more business coming from Uber, they start spending more time on Uber than spending time elsewhere, which leads to even more availability of cabs on Uber, and so even lower pickup times and even more cab requests. So what you see over here is that simple changes in the business have huge effects because they fuel this whole loop. Think of another change. Uber has a rating system where you can rate the driver. And because of the rating system, Uber then takes out drivers who are not performing as well as they should be, which in turn leads to a better experience for subsequent travelers because they only get to see the best drivers. And that in turn leads to even more cab requests. And so you see that there's something there's a lot of very small changes, some things that we often think of as features on an app, but that have a huge bearing on the ultimate business model over here. And finally, this is the reason why search pricing also works. And I'm not justifying search pricing, I think it's a whole PR fiasco the way it works, but there's a specific economic reason search pricing is implemented, and that's because if one of these two sites outbalances the other, if there are more requests than drivers, then potentially offering higher incentives to drivers brings more drivers on board and then sets this whole loop working again. So that's how, this is something that you can draw for every business and try to figure out whether it's working in a certain way for your business and what are the kinds of factors that lead to really high scale for your business. I want to skip this part in the interest of time, and we can probably take it up in if we have questions towards the end, but I want to end on this one note in the last 1 or 2 minutes, and that's this, that every industry in the world has opportunities for platforms to come in. Let me take the example of the industry that has been disrupted most by platforms, the media industry. It's a model, media has always worked in this traditional pipe model. And what we're seeing is platforms attacking each layer of this pipe, even if they're not attacking the whole thing. If you think of the content creation layer, there are platforms like Help a Reporter Out that help you find, that help a reporter find anybody out there to question and to interview for a media piece. Wiki is a platform that came out of Asia that that used a crowd of contributors to create subtitles for Japanese videos and then sold those subtitled videos in the US at a really hefty price. And that's an example of using external users to create content for you rather than using internal employees. Huffington Post, again, started with using internal employees to create content but then phased it out to an external set of contributors. Editorial, again, has moved into a platform model. The example I'll take specifically is Reddit. If you use Reddit, traditionally the editor of a newspaper would decide what news is good and what is not, but on Reddit, the whole community decides what is worth reading and what is not. Content distribution is moving in a platform model. If you think of BuzzFeed, you're creating content which is optimized for a certain channel. Now, I don't necessarily condone the kind of content that it creates, but my main point is that we're at a point where the entire media value chain at various points is seeing attack by platforms. And so the question is not whether your whole industry will move towards platforms, but what is the one opportunity within your industry where you can put in a platform solution and break the way things work today? Finally, content consumption is moving towards platforms. If you think of Flipboard, it started as a new consumption interface, but today it's a platform. It allows people to create their own Flipboard magazines and become curators in their own right. So I want to end it on this note, and I want to leave this whole discussion with the one central thing that I've been talking about also today. Traditionally, we have believed that we are in the business of building products and services. And I believe that that world is fast coming to an end, or is fast becoming less relevant than a world where we are moving to in a direction where we are now all in the business of enabling interactions. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much. Sangeet, please remain on stage. We're going to have some 20 to 30 minutes for our question and answer.